Hey, what's going on, everyone? I hope you guys are having a wonderful day today. Just want to see how this. Okay, well, I want to give you guys the gospel first, and then I'm going to give you a quick message from Romans chapter 1. Okay, the gospel is found in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 4, and that is that Jesus Christ died for our sins, was buried, and on the third day rose from the dead for our justification. Jesus always existed, he is this. Second person of the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We call it the Godhead, okay? It's also called the Trinity, but even though the Trinity is not mentioned in the Bible, but the Godhead is, okay? And I'm going to show you that, well, if we get to it, you know. But it's in Romans chapter 1, okay? But I want you guys to understand something. That God wants us to believe in his Son, Jesus Christ, his death, burial, resurrection, and his finished, trusting his finished redemptive work on the cross. For the forgiveness of all our sins, past, present, and future. Okay? Jesus is coming, guys. You know, everything is amping up. You know, while things kind of seem a bit silent, slightly, it is actually building up. It is actually building up. So I would just pray that all who have not been saved will believe the gospel now than before the rapture takes place. And the rapture will be taking place when? Soon. Don't know how soon, but we know it's soon. It can't be that far out, guys, you know, based on what's happening around the world right now, you know. I mean, this beast system is just keeps, like, piling and stacking, okay? But I want to talk about something. So we know when you look at the book of Romans, right, I actually find the book of Romans to be like a complete package, you know. What you would say, complete package by all by itself anyway, okay? Because it takes you from law to grace, you know, beginning to end, really. You know, it's such an excellent book. But in discussing Romans chapter 1, Romans chapter 1 is God's general indictment of humanity, of the world, okay? We see that in chapter 1. In chapter 2, it becomes specific, God's indictment specific to Israel, and then specific to the Greeks or the Gentiles, okay? And then chapter 3 is God's verdict, okay? And in that verdict is where you hear, you know, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All, that means everyone, okay? Now, we know that there is none righteous, okay? Apart from Christ, no one is righteous, okay? So that when God said that there's none that is righteous on earth, when he looked, he wasn't referring to those who were saved. He was referring to those who were unsaved. These are unbelievers. Everyone that's an unbeliever is unrighteous in God's eyes, okay? Everyone that is saved, that have trusted in Christ Jesus, is now made righteous by the blood of Christ, okay? And by their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? So we are now going to navigate to Romans chapter 1. I want to show you something. You know, a lot of times people like to point fingers at certain sins. Let me tell you something. Romans chapter 1 gives you so much list. We could read on and on and on. And this is to show you that in some way, shape, or form, anyone from any part of the world is guilty of at least one. Of at least one. And if you're guilty of any, you are guilty before God. So the way he explains it, none is righteous, and you cannot make yourself righteous. You need Christ for that. And he made sure that you can't go around it apart from his Son. So his Son is the only means by you can be made righteous, because it is a divine intervention. And that divine intervention can only come by you receiving the free gift of salvation by faith alone, okay? Not of anything that you can do concerning works or any addition to salvation is null and void at that point, okay? It has to be strictly by grace through faith in Christ alone for salvation, okay? Look at this. So, we start from verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen. So you claiming to be an atheist, that makes no difference to God. You claiming that Jesus is not, that makes no difference to God. You claim that Jesus is not God, that makes no difference to God. Okay, it makes absolutely no difference. His word stands true. You are wasting your breath. And then it says, being understood by the things that are made. We know. Everyone knows. Your conscience agrees with God constantly, okay? Even if you claim to not believe in God yourself, all you're doing is fighting your conscience. But deep down inside, your conscience agrees with God. So, I mean, that's just how he made us, okay? We all know him. The only difference is you don't have him. You're not his child until you believe in his son, okay? Now look what he said. Being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead. Hear that? Remember we're talking about the Trinity? We talk about the Godhead. What consists of the Godhead? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Okay? We know that there is a creator. We know that there is an intelligent design to make something like this earth and the wind and the sun, the moon, the clouds, the rain, the snow, you know, different seasons. I mean, we can go on and on and on and see what God has done. Denying any of that changes nothing because God already said, you know deep down inside that it is him. So you trying to convince yourself that God doesn't exist doesn't change the fact that he does exist. You trying to convince yourself that Jesus Christ is not the Son of God is not going to change the fact that Jesus is the Son of God. You trying to convince yourself that there's no such thing as the Holy Spirit, that it was all made up, it's not going to change the fact that there is such a thing as the Holy Spirit, okay? And they're not a thing, it's a person of Christ, a person of Jesus Christ, God the Son, and a person of God the Father, okay? So this is the Godhead. And Paul is writing to the church in Rome, okay? And the church in Rome, he's writing from Corinth to the church in Rome, okay? And by the way, this, like the Catholics say, oh, you know, that the church started with Peter, you know, remember that? Peter, that's why you have the St. Peter's, you know, Basilica, you know, I believe that's the oldest one, you know. First of all, Peter didn't start anything, okay? And they're always trying to quote, you know, Jesus when he says, you know, on this rock I will build my church. Well, first of all, that's where you're flawed in your first understanding of scripture. Who is the rock? Peter is not the rock. It is Christ. He is the foundation, okay? He is the rock. God does not build his church, which is the body of Christ, on a man. He built it on himself. Who is the body of Christ? Because the church is not a building. The church is a body of Christ. So what is our foundation? Is our foundation in Peter or is our foundation in Jesus Christ? Well, it's your foundation in Jesus Christ. So therefore, we can now come to understanding and agreement that is not Peter. So the Catholic Church was not founded by Peter. Peter was not the first pope. So y'all could quit lying to yourselves, okay? You just stop it. I'm sorry this is not an attack on Catholics, but I grew up Catholic myself, so I know what I'm talking about, okay? He's not the first pope, okay? I mean, but they have you believe this, but that's not true, okay? You have to see scriptures for what it is. But anyway, back to God's wrath against sin in this topic. This is chapter 1. Remember, I'm talking about general indictment, God's general indictment against humanity, okay? And if you read further down, because I don't want to make this video long, I would suggest you go read the rest of, you know, chapter 1. You read further down, and you can see from here, you can see all the stuff that God listed. As a matter of fact, let's just read that part, okay? Being filled with all unrighteousness, talk about everyone on earth at the time, okay? This, you know, everyone on earth, okay? Apart from those who were saved now, obviously, but general indictment. Fornication, that means that's not dating, that's fornication, okay? So there are Christians who condemn the LGBT, but you got boyfriend and girlfriend shacking up, you know what I'm saying? Like, give me a break, you know? you are no better. So I have to, throw it out there because people are always trying to elevate one, against the other, So a sin done in the flesh is a sin done in the flesh, This is why Paul always trying to say to abstain from sexual immorality, Why did he say that? Because you are a walking tabernacle as a believer. You are a walking tabernacle of God, okay? That's why he says to abstain, because God is with you the whole time. So whatever you do in the body, he's there with you, okay? That's what Paul is talking about, okay? But anyway, look what is written here: unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. See that? So he's trying to reveal the heart, the core heart of humanity, how wicked humanity is. So when you want to, pinpoint one thing, remember, there's a list going on, okay? But this does not apply to the righteous anymore, because all of this listed here was nailed on the cross for every single one of us who have come to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. So no longer can God look at you and look at this list and say, look at you. Nope. When God looks at you, he sees himself, he sees the Holy Spirit, and he sees his Son, Jesus Christ, the fullness of the Godhead that dwells in you. This is why you are a walking tabernacle. I want you guys to really grasp this, okay? Live in the new identity you have in Christ. Your old man does not define who you are anymore, okay? Stop clinging to your old man. Walk in your new identity in Christ. And by doing so, is by resting in his grace, rest in his finished redemptive work, and grow in the knowledge of God by reading scriptures and asking God to help you understand, okay? The Holy Spirit is there for us, guys. God is there for us. We just have to keep pressing on, okay? Jesus is coming soon. Please don't let anyone condemn you, because there is no condemnation for us who are already saved. The condemnation is reserved for those who are unsaved, the unbelievers, okay? None of us are condemned. Not one child of God is condemned, okay? As a matter of fact, let me put it to you how Peter, in 2 Peter, Peter actually talked about that. Us, yes, born-again believers, are the glorious ones. You are the glorified ones, the glorious ones. Come on now. Even though we have not physically, but positionally we are already, okay? Because that is what we are waiting for, is to receive that finally once we meet Christ. And by the way, Jesus is the one who presents you for himself, spotless and blameless. You don't do it. You hear people say, make sure you wash your garments. You don't do jack, because that is not your garment anyway. It is his garment put on you. That is God's own garment, and he has already made you clean. So to say wash your garments is like, so it's not dirty again. No. The righteousness of Christ is the righteousness of God. It doesn't become unrighteous and then he make you righteous all over again. That's not how that works, okay? Righteousness comes by believing, by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? So, you hear him say, make sure you have oil in your lamp. You're not making sure you have oil in your lamp, nothing. Either you saved or you're not. If you believe the gospel, you have the Holy Spirit, which is the oil. It doesn't run out, It's where you have to, how do you fill it up? How do you fill it up? I mean, come on, people. There's all these lingos that's been tossed around, in a Christian circle where you've heard that for so long, We don't even think about what we say. We just say it because we've heard it for so much, and not even processing. But we have to start processing things based on our new identity in Christ. It is important. Know yourselves. Know who you are in Christ. And see yourself the way God sees you, as righteous. Someone who has been forgiven all sins, past, present, and future. Someone who has been made righteous by your faith in his Son, Jesus Christ. Someone who has been reconciled back to God. Someone who has been made a co-heir with Christ himself, okay? Someone who have a heavenly inheritance, okay? Someone who can never be condemned. Someone who have eternal life. Someone whose salvation can never be lost. Someone who is in God's hands and protected and sealed. You have to see yourself better than what you look at yourself. The enemy is very good at trying to convince other believers that they're not good enough. God is mad at you. You know, look at you. Look what you've done. And just tear you down so you can walk around with your head down. No. Yes, when we mess up, we need to acknowledge that we messed up. You can't pretend that that didn't happen, you know. I acknowledge before God, you know, Lord, because the Holy Spirit will have you, you know. he will correct you, you know. Right away, I'm like, hey, look, I'm like, oh, man, you know, yeah, that's not right. That's not right. You know, I shouldn't have said that, you know. I feel, you know, bad after that, you know. But I'm like, man, I shouldn't have said that. Oh, Lord, I'm so sorry. I shouldn't have said that. But does that mean that if I don't say it, that God, no, all have been forgiven, people, okay? But it's for conscience sake. I pretty much acknowledge, just like you want your child, when they do something wrong, you don't want them walking around puffed up like, yeah, you know, so, okay. I mean, I know I messed up, but okay, whatever. But when they actually acknowledge that they've done something, even though you're not going to punish them because they messed up, you know that, you know what I'm saying, as a good parent, you know, instead of beating them up, that they messed up when they're acknowledging. No, you encourage them, you know, to do better, you know, because you know better for them. God wants us to do better, people. Please be encouraged, okay? You're going through struggles. Many people are going through struggles, you know, health issues, you know, pain, mental, you know, issues, depression, you name it. Major spiritual attack, okay? It happens, you know? It happens to, you know, to each one of us. But that is not the end of it. It's only temporal. You know, it's only temporal. God got you covered. Okay? God got you covered. So with that being said, I just want you guys to know something. God loves you. And just keep trusting God. Okay? He is coming. Jesus is coming soon, y'all. So be excited for Christ and know that soon and very soon, all this will be over. Finicio. All right, y'all have a wonderful day, okay? Peace.